in Iraq, whether by the EU, by the United States, by other entities. It seems that all of them share the same pattern. They all miss the voice of the people who are living around and across the cultural heritage sites, and also the perspective of how do the people see their own cultural heritage. We speak in a very complicated terminology about cultural heritage diplomacy, all of these ununderstandable concepts for the people. What does the cultural heritage mean to the people? We don't have an answer because we never asked them. We never spoke to the people, for example, who are living around a Nuri Mosque. What do they feel? How does it affect their life? Just recently, some people have returned to live in their houses around a Nuri Mosque, the Asa'a Church, a Tahira Church, people who are working in the old market next to the another UNESCO and EU reconstruction project of Agawat Mosque. People are on daily basis affected by things that are not actually that much connected to cultural heritage. Sometimes when I speak to the people from Mosul, what do you think about cultural heritage? I don't get clear answers because there is no clear view of how do they see it. However, the way they actually think about it is, can the cultural heritage that have been recently discovered by them, by the way, this is a very important point, that we speak a lot about the cultural heritage, but for many people in Mosul, they actually didn't know that this kind of historical site existed before. Now they are re-exploring their history and they are trying to make sense of what do they have in their own city. That's why I believe that any project, whether by the EU and any other entity, should have the people, the normal citizens, not us, the experts, the professionals, the academics, we should have the people themselves getting involved in this. We should at least get their own definition of what cultural heritage means. This is very important point to start with. Also, it's really amazing how cultural heritage and the destruction of cultural heritage in Iraq has become a part of, let me say it this way clearly, enriching international organizations rather than bringing the benefit to the people who are living and affected by the destruction of that cultural heritage. What we want to see is, how can we economize the cultural heritage so the people can benefit directly from it? One of the examples is, we have the artisans in Mosul. We have the local artisans who are supposed to work and who have already the experience of maintaining and preserving the cultural heritage sites. We have seen recently a very important example of a historical site rebuilt by local funds. People have collected their own funds, and an artisan who is known for maintaining the historical sites, it took no more than 8 months to reconstruct the site based and according to the same design. And the site is not just actually bringing the local economy back to life, but it's contributing more and more. When you look at all of the other projects, it takes 5 years in order just to understand how to start rebuilding the site. You know, all of these concepts like assessment, expertise, local expertise, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. While people with no international funds were able to rehabilitate a very important and ancient historical site in less than 8 months. We need to review how the way we are working. We need to review also the concepts of international expertise. Do we really require international expertise when it comes to the reconstruction of historical sites. Of course, we need this kind of umbrella of UNESCO, of EU, etc. But we also need to involve the local governments of these cities, whether in Mosul, Basra, Baghdad, and other cities. We need the people themselves to take actions. Because, Guliam, you know this probably very well. The protection and preservation of cultural heritage cannot be maintained by the EU forever. We need the people to maintain this kind of preservation. And it's very important what Mehiyar mentioned. It's also part of the education system. We need the conservation, the preservation, and all of these concepts to be injected in the education, especially in the universities, so we can train more experts from the universities themselves to contribute more for the reconstruction and rehabilitation. I know that Mosul, for example, since the 90s, had a plan for the preservation of the historical sites, but it never happened. We need to go back to all of these documents. We need to go back to all of these people who have the expertise to bring them back, to put them all on the table, and to start working on this. Again and again, I say we need this international umbrella, but we shouldn't actually focus more on international organizations. The people are still asking, what do you mean by international concepts, international organization, international preservation, and all of these, like, for them, boring terminology. It's very simple to them. I want this site to be rehabilitated. I want this site to benefit me in a direct way. We want, for example, a Nuri Mosque to not only become a museum, it should be returned back to its original status, a lively site that gave the people of Mosul. I don't know if you know that the mosque was originally built in uninhibited location, and after it was rebuilt, it actually became a very lively site that brought all the people together. We probably have another problem and it's a very delicate and sensitive. Should we define the cultural heritage of Iraq or for example, Mosul as a heritage belongs to everyone? We know that we have very problematic approach about this, because the Christian need their cultural heritage sites to be identified as a Christian, the Yazidis, the Muslims, etc. But I think we can find another way of overcoming this problem by economizing the cultural heritage, so the people can forget for a while about their own identity and look at how can we make use of this cultural heritage to benefit the people the most. It's also important to review the international funds for international organizations. Are we going to keep funding international organizations and forgetting the local entities, or is it going to be always like this? Only the internationals have the expertise and the locals have no expertise. I think we have to review all of these policies. And with this project of the EU-funded project on the reconstruction of Mosul and Basra, the two old cities, it's very important to rethink about this. And I would like to mention one important point, and I know how sensitive a question it is in Iraq, and I'm sure that EU doesn't want to be involved in this, but with all of these concepts of diversity, social cohesion, et cetera, we are missing a very important element in the overall cultural heritage. We are missing the Jewish historical sites. I know that the synagogue of Mosul is at a very high risk, and all the proposals have been rejected, and no one wants to be involved in this. Even the EU sometimes kind of like distant itself from this kind of project. The cultural heritage belongs to everyone, yes, but we have to also be very sensitive when we deal with the identity-related issues, especially in Mosul, Nineveh, and the rest of Iraq. Thank you.
Right, Thanks a lot, Omar, for sharing with us. To bring your voice and remember to us what cultural heritage means, and before all that we work for people. And you raise a lot of complex issues, and I know we already discussed that of the, let's say, difficult terminology of our diplomacy of international organization. But you already raised this question of expertise, this new way of exploring. You're really, I like to depict you like that, a survivor that turned historian, no living in Paris, no teaching heritage, and trying to decomplexify the language of heritage. I guess you already answered my both questions that I have on perspective, so I will now turn, thanks a lot, Omar, for sharing all that with us. And we will be back after in the Q&A. I'm sure people will have a lot of questions for both of you, Omar and Mehiyar. I would like to turn now to Gabriel. Gabriel Munuera, you're the head of division of the Arabian Peninsula and Iraq at the European External Action Service. You're a senior diplomat of the European Union. You have heard Martin, our ambassador from Baghdad, saying that cultural heritage is really now, it was not before in the traditional portfolio of the European Union, but now really become a key asset in building peace, in helping for development. My first question to you, after having heard to Mehiyar and Homer, is how far the current European Union action might contribute to protecting heritage in Iraq?
Thank you very much, Guillaume, and good afternoon to everybody. A real pleasure to be here with you all, talking about this obviously very, very significant and important topic. First of all, let me, of course, recall that Iraq is currently facing multiple political, economic, and security challenges, in addition to COVID-19 pandemic. And let me reaffirm the EU's commitment to continue supporting the government of Prime Minister Kathem as it undertakes urgent reforms, enhancing cooperation across the policy board under the EU-Iraq Partnership and Cooperation Agreement. I want to recall also that the EU is heavily invested in Iraq through stabilization efforts under the Global Coalition Against Daesh, reconstruction, humanitarian and development support, as well as civilian security sector reform through the EU assistance mission on Iraq. Most lately, including $159 million package to help address the health and socioeconomic impact of COVID. And the EU, of course, stands ready to work together with the government of Iraq in support of regional stability in full respect of Iraq's sovereignty. The EU active engagement includes HIVP engagement with Iraqi leaders, implementation of the Partnership and Cooperation Agreement, and really across the policy board. When it comes to cultural heritage in Iraq, indeed, as Martin indicated in the video, this focus from our side on the cultural heritage in Iraq is a relatively new addition to our portfolio. Traditionally, we have dealt with cultural heritage through the prism of security, the fight against the trafficking of cultural goods as a source of financing terrorism and organized crime. It is a direct outcome of the cultural heritage destruction witnessed by the Islamic State in particular. The increasing focus of cultural relations and heritage, evidenced by the EU-funded programs in Iraq, builds on a growing and stronger EU-Iraq partnership that we have been actually building over the past few years. In this context, culture and its heritage become an important component that guides our overall action. We have adopted an EU strategy for Iraq in 2018, still very much valid today, with a joint communication to the European Parliament and the Council that clearly mentions that the EU should seek to support international efforts to prevent the trafficking in cultural goods and to restore and preserve Iraq's cultural heritage. This commitment is reiterated in the latest EU member states reflection document on policy recommendations vis-a-vis Iraq, where our member states agreed to support the government of Iraq in protecting its cultural heritage, also as a way to reinforce cultural identity in the country. When it comes to the protection of cultural heritage in Iraq, in particular, we have two main axes of efforts that was mentioned already by Martin as well, security and development. And here I would like to flag three important actions contributing directly to protecting heritage in Iraq, which are also drivers of stability. These actions are interesting as they use more or less the whole spectrum of what we call the EU toolbox. One action is the exceptional assistance measure in favor of Iraq, Libya, Syria, and Yemen, and the instrument contributing to stability and peace, protecting cultural heritage and diversity in conflicts. And this we do in partnership with UNESCO, which includes safeguarding measures and risk assessment. Also, we call a common security and defense policy mission, I mentioned before, the EU assistance mission in Iraq. It's the sole mission with a dedicated task on cultural heritage, protecting cultural values, enhancing the Iraqi heritage, and preventing the root causes of extremism are among the key factors in the stabilization efforts in Iraq, where our mission is involved. Thirdly, reviving the spirit of Mosul and Basra, a project that we conduct in partnership also with UNESCO under the Development Fund. Iraq's most emblematic historical cities left destroyed by the occupation of the Islamic State. Mosul is the living symbol of Iraq's pluralistic identity. EU funding in this regard will promote social cohesion and reconciliation through the restoration and reconstruction of historic urban landscapes. So this is a little bit the gist of what we do, or an approach to Iraq, and we hope that to be making a significant contribution in this area, and of course, more and better can always be done. Happy to continue discussing, of course, and to exchange in the questions and answer. Thanks a lot, Guillaume.
Well, thanks a lot, Gabriel, for really this excellent presentation. And I really underline, and you join your voice to Martin well on the action already implemented by the European Union on security and development and these three main initiatives. Just in really 2 minutes of time before we switch to the question and answer with the attendants, if you want to highlight very synthetically any perspective of the European Union engagement and what would be our added value. We have heard a lot of Omar and Mehiyar saying that, speaking of the neutrality of a new way to engage with international organizations. So if you can just in 2 minutes give the key answers you want to provide us on the European Union added value and perspective in the field.
Well, clearly within what we call our EU's integrated approach, cultural heritage has been identified as a driver of conflict and its protection as a component for peace, security, and development. The work done, as I mentioned, in partnership with UNESCO, EU member states, the government of Iraq, shows that we have a clear interest to develop our support for the protection of cultural heritage and link it as a vector of security and resilience for the country. It may also permit to gain trust, but also to work on the drivers of the resilience and recovery in the country. In terms of value added, I think that Europe is increasingly perceived as a global point of reference, strong and reliable political partner that invests in stability and resilience. And this is the case in Iraq, absolutely. There are two key elements here. One, I would call neutrality and trust. Cultural heritage might be a sensitive topic linked to political maneuvering sometimes. The EU in this regard is perceived, we believe, as a multilateral, broader kind of organization, and therefore a neutral partner without sort of hidden agendas, without baggage. And we have access to a wide range of policies, financial instruments, and technical expertise. We have a comprehensive integrated toolbox. Our capacity to have partnership with international and regional organizations is also positively viewed. The work that we have been carrying with UNESCO is in this regard of relevance. These are the key assets for the EU to engage with local authorities and build trust, especially in this field. Another important element is coordination. Cultural heritage might also benefit from the EU coordination perspective, as I mentioned, a joined up approach with the humanitarian development peace nexus. EU development, humanitarian and security actors have started working hand in hand, more than ever before, and also coordination with our member states, which is relevant also very much in this field. In Iraq, some EU member states are active, like for example, France, Italy, or Germany in this area. And alongside a former EU member with whom we maintain close relations on the ground, of course, the United Kingdom. In this regard, when it comes to perspectives for the protection of cultural heritage in Iraq, I would say that the work presented in the expert report that was discussed a few minutes ago is of great importance and provide some perspectives to develop our action in the field. EU main areas of support for the future may be political partnership on the one hand, enhance the EU as a strong and reliable political partner, enhancing connections with the national authorities in the field of culture, the Ministry of Culture and the State Board of Antiquities and Heritage. Security and stability support, in line with the work of EUAM Iraq, keeping fighting against trafficking, increasing advice and training to state actors, develop capacity with the national authorities to develop a database for the stolen artifacts connected to the one in Interpol. Development and recovery, of course, tangible heritage, the destruction of Islamic State are still numerous and everywhere, and there is need for reconstruction and recovery. The projects of that the EU that we are funding in Mosul and Basra are fundamental in this regard. And some targeted projects might for sure be developed in a strategic perspective. But also intangible heritage. Intangible heritage plays a very important part with the objective to help build a common understanding and think to support heritage in a wider perspective with sustainable development, employment, and education. These are all some perspectives to be explored. And obviously, happy to continue discussing. Thanks a million.
Well, thanks a lot, Gabriel, for this precious insight. And I think we can all read your perspective with the session number one we had this morning on this new instrument, you remember, with the long name of NDCI and the funding perspective that we might have. So it's really precious that we might connect all these initiatives. Thanks to the three of you for this first session of discussion we have together. We will now jump to the Q&A session. And the first question, let me quite address, as we said, the elephants in the room we have, and a lot of questions arise around that. The United States, the recent election in the United States, is it going to change? Well, I will say anything, but very, very simple question. So what are the perspective for you, you can assess in terms of protection of cultural heritage and cultural heritage? And we know that USS is quite involved in Iraq. So any driver for change and any perspective on that? And the question is really for the three of you. So maybe Mehiyar, we can start with you on this point if you want to share with us.
Yeah, just a couple of points regarding this. I think things will change. As Mehiyar will be, if indeed Biden becomes president, then there'll be a change in policy. And that policy obviously involves the type of relationship the US aspires to have with the EU, cooperation, multilateralism, which is very important, obviously, for the EU and for the kind of problems we have, for the challenges we have globally. But I also think it will change in terms of programs, programming in the Middle East. And I think that's really important to note because a significant amount of money has been crafted in a way by USAID over the past few years that looks at one particular group. These are deeply politicized projects, and they're worth tens and tens, perhaps even hundreds of millions of dollars. So things will change on the ground. That doesn't mean there won't be a need on the ground for some of those important projects that are being worked on. But I think there's the changes that are happening in the US will call for more cooperation with the EU, which is a good thing, because obviously the challenges are immense. I mean, they're enormous in the Middle East and they'll continue to be grave over the next 10, 15 years. So this is a new positive change, I think, if indeed there is this kind of new interest in strengthening relationships and partnerships with the EU and respective member states.
Thanks a lot, Mehiyar. Omar or Gabriel, if you want to
I'm not sure to what extent anything will be changed according to the change that's happening in the United States. We will not see any significant impact on Iraq and on the cultural heritage. What I hear from especially USAID, USIP, etc., they are getting more interested actually in the cultural heritage. And the United States itself has suffered from the lack of the cultural heritage diplomacy recently, and their withdrawal from many agreements has been viewed as kind of like a bad idea. But given that they are trying to go more in more activities in the Middle East regarding the cultural heritage, trying to fix the problems that were caused by the former president of the United States when he threatened to destroy and target cultural heritage sites, I expect we will see more effective engagement from the United States in the cultural heritage. And to be honest, the United States is the only country that stepped in to protect the Jewish cultural heritage in Iraq. We haven't seen this from any other part. So we have to build on this in order to bring them to be more effective and more active in such situations.
Thanks Omar, for that. I don't know, Gabriel, if you want to comment, or you're mute, Gabriel. We cannot hear you, unfortunately.
Sorry, I was muted. Difficult for me to comment on the future policies of a future U.S. administration. Just to say that the U.S. Has been and will remain a crucial partner for us. We will continue working very, very closely with the U.S. On Iraq, in Iraq, and obviously if the future U.S. administration is keen on working more in this area, we'll be very happy to do that with them. Absolutely.
Well, thanks a lot, Gabriel. And we have a question for you in the chat. Directly saying, what could the European do in Iraq to help create more local jobs in the cultural heritage sector? Mm-hmm. Gabriel, this one is for you.
Well, I think that clearly a number of the projects that we are supporting, that we are funding, have a local component. And obviously, I think that in the context of this perspective, in the context of the thinking of more things that we can do in this field, it is always of fundamental importance to bear in mind the local dimension of this. And obviously, the possibility of also creating jobs, creating capacity and building capacity locally. So clearly this is a very, very important, crucial consideration that we will continue bearing in mind as we develop the new perspectives in this field.
Thanks a lot, Gabriel. I don't know if Mehiyar and Omar, you
want... May I respond to Ambassador Ramon, please?
Yes, we will discuss it in a second part of a question. I just want to raise before a question, which is targeted for you, Omar, from Chantal Laurent, who is architect. And she thanks you for raising the great deal of problems that affect the reconstruction and the conflict resolution among the different communities. So really a question targeting the different communities. Have you thought of a strategy to address this issue that affects the different communities? And secondly, a second question, or what can we do with the heritage which is definitely destroyed in Iraq, as for example, the tomb of Joshua?
I think she is referring to the tomb of Jonah. We don't have Joshua in Mosul. It's a very sensitive, delicate, problematic situation regarding the connection between the communities. You probably all know that one of the biggest consequences of Daesh was this kind of like Daesh dismantled the social cohesion of Mosul, the social status and the social infrastructure of the people. So the cultural heritage sites and the reconstruction of the cultural heritage sites, whether they are religious or normal historical sites, can help in reintroducing the meaning of identity that brings all the people together. You probably are aware of the recent argument in Mosul that the people now are addressing and even addressed by the Archbishop of Mosul. Now they are trying to gain or to get kind of like acknowledgement that certain Islamic sites have been built on over the former Christian sites. This is a very big problem, and we have to carefully address this question. We have to think of how can we tell everyone that this heritage represents you all, but at the same time, we protect the statue of the site, is it if it's Christian, Islamic, Yazidi, Turkman, etc. I think this is the responsibility of the Iraqi government to address. This is the responsibility of the local authorities to deal with, and with more engagement from the youth movement that is growing in the city of Mosul and Nineveh Plains and the other parts of Nineveh province. It's the more we address the young people to reintroduce the cultural heritage, to also the first thing to start with is we should have on our table, all of us, we should have a definition of what cultural heritage mean by the people themselves, not our own definitions. We have to ask them, what do you think of the cultural heritage? What does it represent to you? How do you reflect this cultural heritage? How does it reflect your own life? Once we have these kind of definitions, I think we can make a good policy. And also for the Prophet Juna side, it's still an opportunity to actually contribute to the stabilization and peace building in Mosul if there is a good plan to present this site as a site of multiculturalism and that it could be a place to represent all the religions, because this site doesn't only represent the three religions in Mosul, but it also represents many different historical layers of the city, whether it's the Assyrian history, the Abbasid, the Islamic, Christian, Jewish, etc. It can become a very important, while maintaining the Islamic status of the site, we can create kind of like a cultural center next to it that represent everyone else. And if you allow me to respond to Ambassador Ramon, we don't reject international support, but I have to be honest here that the destruction of the cultural heritage sites in Iraq, especially in Mosul, and all of this movement of reconstruction has become in many ways a way of enriching international organizations. It became kind of like a business rather than representing the real meaning of reconstruction. We need the international expertise, of course, but we have to review how this is actually maintained and produced. Are we going to create business for international organizations, or are we going to make this money that is used for the reconstruction, but at the same time for enhancing the local economy and the stabilization? Thank you.
Many thanks, Omar, for what you say, for your word. And sorry, it was the tomb of Jonah for sure. I should have corrected myself before reading the question. There is a debate, and this is really interesting what you said, because there is an ambassador, Ramon Bloika, who was the former European Union ambassador to Iraq, posed the question, and you raise it, of the involvement of international community. And Mehiyar already tackled the question with a report, and because he framed the need to have a strategic framework of engagement. So I think it's really a question for you, Mehiyar and Gabriel. Echoing what Omar said, how do you perceive the next years, the mid and long-term involvement of our international organization and the international community in the protection of cultural heritage. So we need any shifts, though we need the strategic framework and echoing to the word of Omar. So Mehiyar, maybe if you want first to intervene.
Add to some of the discussion I'll answer your question is that there hasn't been, in terms of Iraq, there hasn't been a needs assessment of Iraq's heritage priorities and what it needs right now. I think often because we don't have those needs assessment, it's reflected negatively on international work, because then there's a discrepancy between what is needed on the ground and what is thought to be of a priority from outside the country. And I think this is some of the things that have been mentioned. And I think it's really important that we work with our strategic partners in the country, in this case, the Ministry of Culture, Ministry, the State Board of Antiquities and Heritage, which is a component of the Ministry of Culture. And we work with them over, you know, 5, 10, 15 years. And I think we need to have a mental shift in terms of the way we look at projects, if you like, moving away from projects, maybe into programs, and having these strategic partnerships with key countries that are undergoing massive cultural heritage destruction and change. Libya, obviously, Yemen, Iraq are key countries in this regard. And I think that's essential, because if we do not have a needs assessment, it's very, very difficult to understand what's going on the ground. The other point I would like to make, and particularly when we look at a strategic framework regarding cultural heritage, we have to understand the nature of the political systems that are emerging in this region, in the Middle East. In Iraq in particular, there's a significant amount of fracture, right, and fragmentation and pushing and pulling regarding control of cultural resources. Because cultural resources are also important when it comes to elite political groups. And these elite groups are trying to carve up their own sort of fiefdom to legitimize themselves. So what does the EU do in this case? When you have this amount of fragmentation, in many ways, we're only as good as the partners we work with. And if our partners over there are at this level of fragmentation, then we have to be very strategic about who we work with. And unfortunately, I haven't yet seen a real strategic partnership with the Ministry of Culture, State Board of Antiquities and Heritage. We have a minister at the moment who's reforming, who's looking into massive reforms within the Ministry of Culture. I mean, that is a possible key actor that we could work with, a national actor, but we haven't explored those options. So I think any kind of strategic framework, like I mentioned before, we have to think about key tenets, principles, values, that we mentioned, access, human dignity, and some of those things. But I think on the ground, there has to be change, as what's being said, real change, tangible change on the ground. And the other point I'd like to make is that some of our international cultural institutions are not thinking strategically about these issues. They're being forced, in a way, compelled to become contractor organizations, but not really looking at the long-term implications of cultural heritage and what it means in terms of politics and the future of these countries. So I think it's really important that we have these discussions and take a step back from just responding and delivering programs and thinking about programs, really take a step back and look at where we are now after, in Iraq's case, 17 years of enormous amount of destruction. I think we need to have those debates, and those debates are not necessarily about projects and programs and what we can do on the ground, even though that's really, really important. We need a needs assessment. We need to work with our partners on the ground, but we need to think about our own strategy. And our strategy really should be about what we want to see over the next 10, 15 years. So that's a collective effort. And this is why this discussion is really important, because it's a collective effort that involves a lot of partners, a lot, the UK and France and Germany and internationally. It involves a lot of people, a lot of discussions. So I hope that this is an opportunity that we can use to discuss these things, rather than necessarily speaking about this project here and there. We're looking at 10, 15. This is why the idea of a strategic framework is really important, because it helps us understand where we are, where we want to be in 10, 15 years.
Thanks a lot, Mehiyar, for this compliment. Before jumping to Gabriel, just to rephrase, I really like this idea you built of assessment analysis and bringing the Ministry of Culture to have a partnership. It's another level which is quite interesting, and the collective effort and complementary of what Omar you said. And you remember, it's really connected to the discussion we have this morning with the session number 2, and we have Valérie Frélan from ALIF, we have Aparna from Econem, and we have this international organization that have the expertise. So I think it's I really value the very interesting debate we have on also using, on also having this assessment, but also keeping in mind we have this this valuable insight of local people from the international organization of the partnership. Gabriel, floor is yours for you on this debate. You're still muted, Gabriel. I'm sorry, we can't hear you.
Sorry. No, thanks. As I was saying before, I mean, one of the fundamental tenets of what we try to do in Iraq, but elsewhere as well, and also in this field, is partnership and coordination, meaning it is fundamental for us to work hand by hand, very closely with the Iraqi authorities, as I said before, now with the authorities within the government of Prime Minister Kademi, but also to work very, very closely with our member states, the Team Europe spirit that we are very much trying to promote internationally, and also, of course, in Iraq, and also, of course, in this field, and to work with the whole range of the whole gamut of tools that we have in this field, which range from humanitarian to development to security related, because cultural heritage has all these dimensions and all these aspects. And I think that this is very much the way forward that we have to pursue.
Well, many thanks, Gabriel, Mehiyar, and Omar for your insight. I guess we all, let me check my digital screen. We do not have any more questions. So I will do a kind of rapid wrap up of our conversation. That was a really, really intense and interesting and fruitful debate that we have all together with you, Omar, Mehiyar, and Gabriel. I really value the really frank, friendly, and honest exchange that we have. Omar, I see your hand.
Yeah, I would like, I just want to finish with this. We have to be careful not to transform our cities into museums, not to transform our people or museumize the cultural heritage sites. These sites have to restore their own life that is directly connected to the people. So when we look at any historical site, we should first look at the people who are mostly affected by this. We have to be careful of the museumization of our cultural heritage sites and cultural heritage in general. And it's very important to bring on board the people, the local authorities, of course, the international organizations, the international expertise, but we have to take always in consideration the human side of all of this. Let us not museumize our cultural heritage, please.
Thanks a lot, Omar. And you're right, and I will take your words, not to transform a museum, and a colleague and friend in the chat say not to transform it in Disneyland. So not in museum or not in any attraction and over, you're right. Based on our really, really excellent discussion, what I again is this question of having a kind of decomplexified language, and Omar, you're right, in how we speak, because we do not need to forget that we are working for people on whatever level we are, at diplomats level, at international organization, at state level, at ground level. The first preoccupation might be the people, the security, the resilience, and the happiness of people at the end. So it's really something I value from our discussion. I really value this really interesting discussion also of the complexity of using cultural heritage. And I guess that Iraq really provides an excellent example of a complexity with a superposition of communities. You discuss this question of communities, of religion. You discuss the Jewish patrimoine of Omar. We discuss the government issue. We discuss the international organization issue. So I guess cultural heritage is a vivid example of the complexity of how and how we might have an analysis and assessment respecting our value or of interest and try to bring back peace, resilience, development and happiness to the community, not to transform to a museum, but really to a living and a happy place to live. So I want to wrap up like that. I want to thank you all from the bottom of my heart, Omar, Mehiyar and Gabriel, for this really excellent and vivid conversation. Thanks to all of you. I hope the attendants really enjoyed the discussion. Really glad to continue the conversation. I'm sure we will continue bilaterally, the three of us. But really, shukran, thanks a lot to all of you. And we will wrap up like that. We will have a digital break and we will resume in 20 minutes for the session number 4 on the CSDP mission and cultural heritage.
Thank you very much, Guillaume. A real pleasure. And thanks a lot, you and your colleagues, for putting this together. Very important. Thank you.
Thank you, Guillaume. Ciao.
Thank you.